Unless the grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains a single grain. If it dies, it bears much fruit. Thousands of people around the world have been inspired by the life of Charles de Foucauld, a man who was killed in 1916 in the Sahara Desert, where he had gone to live out his love for Jesus among the Muslim people.
I think about Charles and the impact he's made in my life is, how can I bring myself to prayer every day? How can I bring the children that I work with, the people in this community, how can I become, through this community, that we are a more loving presence of Christ in the world? And this is how I live it day by day.
This man who wanted to be a brother to all died alone, leaving neither converts nor any sign of the religious orders which he had dreamed of founding. What was the vision which moved him and which has captivated the hearts and lives of so many? What does he have to say for today's world? What is this message which is able to touch people from such different cultural backgrounds and draw them together? Viscount Charles de Foucauld was born in Strasbourg, France, in 1858. Orphaned as a child, he inherited a privileged life from his wealthy family. While serving as an officer in the French military, he was known for his outrageous and undisciplined behavior.
I went further from you, my lord. My life started to be a death. You allowed me to feel a great sadness, an emptiness. I was in total darkness. There was nothing left but myself. It was absolute selfishness.
At the age of 25, he undertook a risky geographical survey expedition in Morocco, for which he later won a prize from the French Geographical Society. This trip represented a turning point in his life.
The faith of Islam troubled me deeply. The sight of these believing people living in the continual presence of God made me aware of something greater and truer than my own worldly preoccupations.
3 years later, he underwent a deep personal conversion.
As soon as I believed there was a God, I could do nothing else than to live for Him alone.
Charles de Foucauld has impacted my life and impacts it now, and it moves me now, is this sense of community with Jesus as the center.
Charles' understanding of his vocation evolved throughout his life. He spent 7 years as a Trappist monk, later in Nazareth, living as a hermit and working as a handyman for the poor Clares, he wrote.
I have found here what I searched for, in my daily labor, in my nights of prayer. It is what I have desired for years. This hidden life of our Lord in obscurity and humility.
His ordination as a Catholic priest at 42 years of age redirected the rest of his life, leading him back to Algeria and the Muslim people. He understood his call as a way of translating his ideal of Nazareth into the ordinary events of daily life.
Charles de Foucauld left us a message. He left us a spirituality, the spirituality of Nazareth. To be in touch with reality, in touch with the suffering of our people, to not only share in their sufferings, but also to celebrate the hopes and dreams of our people.
Charles reached Tamaracet and the Tuareg people in 1905. He sought a contemplative life among the least fortunate of his brothers and sisters, loving Jesus' presence in the lives of those around him and the Eucharist. His belief in this double presence was a unifying factor in his life. A few months before his death, he wrote,
"I think that the words of the gospel which have made the deepest impression on me and changed my life the most are these. Whatever you do to the one of the least of these, you do to me." When we consider that these words come from the mouth of him who said, "This is my body, this is my blood," how great is our desire to seek and to love Jesus in the least of these.
In 1923, 8 years after his death, René Bazin published the first biography of Charles de Foucauld. It touched the hearts of new generations who continue to draw inspiration from his life and witness. The grain of wheat which fell to the ground has borne fruit. In 1933, 17 years after Charles de Foucauld's death, a group of women took his rule as a norm for their religious life. To imitate Jesus in his ordinary life in Nazareth, to adore him in the Blessed Sacrament, and to live in mission areas is the vocation of the Little Sisters of the Sacred Heart of Jesus. Amongst the sisters dispersed in various countries throughout the world, there are six in Bolivia, one community in the countryside, and the other in the city of Potosí, whose famous silver mines enrich the Spanish colonial empire. Today, it is one of the poorest cities of South America.
My vocation as a little sister was born in Bolivia when I worked here as a lay volunteer. The lifestyle of the little sisters and the local people questioned me deeply. I really feel a call from Bolivia, from all the poor and suffering people.
The Little Sisters of the Sacred Heart are rooted among the people. They choose to live simple lives and to work alongside others as they try to better their common lot.
I believe that everything stems from the incarnation of Jesus. He taught us that in order to be pleasing to the Father and to live out his plan for us, that we should stay close to his little ones, the poor, the humble, the unloved, the marginalized majorities of humanity. There needs to be a minimum of social and human development. We are all children of God. We cannot simply sit back with our arms crossed.
They are very simple, and above all, they want to live like the poor. They don't make any difference between poor or rich. I like their simplicity. Whenever and wherever, they always speak to you in a tender, motherly way.
We're able to identify with them as we basically live the same life. What I like is that they live in our cultural context. The fact that they are close to us as young people allows them to understand us and be attentive to us.
Our entire lives, no matter how silent or public they are, must preach the gospel by example. We must breathe Jesus with our whole being. Our every action, our whole lives, should proclaim that we belong to Jesus. Our whole lives must be a living witness, a reflection of Jesus, like a perfume of Jesus' presence, something which says, "Jesus."
The contemplative dimension is fundamental in my life. And I believe it is fundamental for anyone who follows Christ. We should see the face of Christ in every human face. For example, in the street where we meet children, adults, old people, and minors. If I don't spend time in front of the Lord, they simply pass by, and nothing more. And what do I have to give them? I need to have the love of God in order to continue to sell my ice cream pops. But in selling them, I must also give the love of Christ. To give them the love of Christ, it is not my love. I have nothing. Rather, I need to be filled with the love of God in order to love others. It's really the contemplation of Christ living in the other.
Let their universal love shine like a beacon, that everyone will see them as universal friends, who spend their lives praying for all humanity without exception and doing good.
René Voyome, a young Frenchman, was deeply touched after reading this biography of Brother Charles. In it, he discovered all of his aspirations as a young man. A missionary life, his attraction to monastic life, and adoration of Jesus present in the Eucharist. In 1933, together with several other newly ordained priests and seminarians, he left for the desert of North Africa, settling in El Abiyat, Algeria. There, in the confines of an abandoned military post, they began to live a monastic life according to the rule written by Brother Charles. Calling themselves the Little Brothers of Jesus, they received their first official recognition in 1936. The brothers slowly discerned the will of God for them, leaving the traditional monastic lifestyle in order to become contemplatives in the heart of the world. René Voyome wrote from Algeria.
Don't define your lives, simply live. It would be easier to know how to live by looking at Jesus. Jesus wants you to be the light of the world, the salt of the earth, the leaven in the dough. Jesus wants us to be present in the midst of humanity. You must therefore allow yourself to be consumed by those who are hungry for the justice of God.
In 1956, René Voyome also founded two other congregations, the Little Sisters and the Little Brothers of the Gospel, who, along with consecrating their contemplative lives in solidarity with those who are marginalized in society, often have a more direct role in pastoral work and community building. Their communities can be found in some 20 countries around the world. There is one community of the Little Brothers of the Gospel in inner city New York. The brothers work in jobs which permit them to be present to the homeless, the immigrant population, the neighborhood youth, and people suffering from the AIDS virus. One of them works in Bethsaida House, a parish hospice for AIDS patients in Brooklyn. He tries to reach out in simple ways.
For me, in my life, people with AIDS is somebody, they bring me to contact with all that is essential in life. You know, the spiritual journey is a journey of cutting through all the, how do you say, all what weighs us down, all what keeps us from the truth. And these people, you know, they don't have time. They don't have time to be fooling around with games or jokes. They're looking for the essential, and they expect me to give the same. So working with people with AIDS is something that, they keep me honest.
Él es una persona.
He is an incredible person. He gives everything for the residents.
He's always willing to help, to be there for them. He loves them dearly.
A couple of brothers also work in the Holy Name Center, where there are public showers, clothing, counseling, and mailroom services for homeless men.
The enormous gift they have as a community is to focus on the person. Whether they do the job well or not in a technical sense is irrelevant, because they do it as a person so well. The warmth, the genuineness, the giving, the real concern that they bring is the major contribution they make.
Now in New York, over the years, I learned what is compassion. Well, I'm still learning it. So I say it is living compassion of Jesus with the people, with the poor. I feel there is a vocation in the church to live the priesthood in this way of living compassion, just compassion.
He makes it easier. He's nice to everyone. And a lot of people come in, they have problems, maybe they had a hard night, you know, and he kind of like deflects it. You know, it makes it easier for them.
Yeah, it's like sunshine.
It all started out as an act of generosity. I've seen people stripped to the bones by pain. We can say that we find in human suffering what other people find in a monastery, a privileged place of meeting with God.
It is through our simple presence in adoration of Jesus that our prayer makes us in, like living in the masses of humanity, as a constant demonstration that it is still possible to pray and adore God in spite of the terrible circumstances in which the great majority of humankind is condemned to live in the 20th century. Another of the community of the Little Brothers of the Gospel can be found in the Umbrian hills in the village of Spello, close to Assisi, Italy, where the spirituality of Charles de Foucauld continues to bear fruit. In the 60s, Brother Carlo Caretto, together with other brothers, fixed up an old abandoned 14th century monastery in order to receive pilgrims who wanted to share in their lifestyle. This community is an open door for lay people to enter into Brother Charles' way of loving Jesus and to carry it back into their daily lives.
What we offer is by no means a course of spiritual exercises. I think it is the fundamental characteristic of this community to share the importance of certain values, not so much by word, but by living them out together.
The Little Brothers will not only welcome their guests with joy, but should invite all to enter into their lives and their homes, as Abraham did with the angel visitors.
The first thing that we all learn is the value of a deep, personal, and passionate relationship with the Lord, which is the heart and soul of each Christian life. It's the rediscovery that contemplation is not something reserved for those who live in cloisters or monasteries, but rather it is the most profound vocation of each and every Christian.
I had never been able to find a spirituality that helped me to integrate these two aspects of contemplation and of presence to the world as a lay person. The Little Brothers have helped me to understand that it is possible to live it.
In the daily sharing of work in the countryside, or in fixing up the hermitages, during the meals and prayers, the pilgrims rediscover the value of community life, and also that it is possible to live this out in our lives, despite our differences.
There's a value in silence and simplicity, in just having the basics. Just as the hermitages are very simple and basic, so too is our life here. It helps us to discover the importance of our relationship with God, with our inner selves, with our neighbors, and with the entire creation.
I think the time here has a very huge impact on me. It helps me focus on what's important to me, what direction my life is going to go in. A place like Spelo is very rare. It stays with me for quite a long time. So I reflect upon it a lot, even when I'm in situations of the opposite nature. When I'm in the middle of a city with a lot of noise and chaos, I think about the time here, the different ways, the way of life, the way of life can be.
The guests at Spelo finish their week with a day of desert in order to live an experience of silence and solitude with God.
It is necessary to go to the desert and remain there a long time in order to receive the grace of God. It is there that you empty yourself completely, letting go of all that is not of God, so that there is room for God alone. This is a time of grace.
The grain of wheat, which died and was silently buried in the Saharan desert, also bore fruit in the life of a French woman, Madeleine Houtan. She, too, had read the biography of Charles de Foucauld.
In Brother Charles, I at last found the ideal I was dreaming of for my life. The gospel in action. Total poverty. A love for lowliness. And first and foremost, love in the fullest meaning of the word. Jesus Caritas. Jesus love.
At the age of 38, she left for Algeria. Early on, she contacted René Vuillaume, and they shared their intuitions and questions. This lifelong collaboration had a tremendous impact on their respective communities.
The entire history of the foundation can be summed up in the words, "God took me by the hand, and blindly I followed." In what seemed the most disconcerting absence of human means, but with an unlimited trust in Jesus, the master of the impossible.
At the beginning, the Little Sisters of Jesus were geared exclusively toward Islam and the nomadic peoples of the Sahara. But in 1946, Madeleine felt that God was asking her to reach out to the entire world, seeking those groups where no one else would go.
Look at the map of the world. Choose to live among the poorest and most forgotten. Among nomads and other ignored and disregarded minorities difficult to reach with other forms of apostolate.
Little Sister Madeleine died November 6, 1989, at the age of 91. Her vision lives on through her 1,300 sisters, scattered in some 60 countries throughout the world.
Before being religious, be human and Christian in all the strength and beauty of these terms. The more you are totally human, the more you will be a religious who gives glory to God.
She wanted the little sisters to be women in the most beautiful sense of the word. When she spoke of being human, it was to have hearts that could be close to those who suffer and to all that goes on in the world. She didn't want us to be strangers to anything that happens in our world, be it the sufferings of war, the sufferings created by social problems, or of families. It would all resonate within our hearts and make us more understanding and respectful.
De compréhension et de respect.
A group of little sisters are part of a circus in the United States. They are migrant workers who travel every day, living in a trailer, working alongside other workers. They have a chapel in the back of their truck.
Our community, since the beginning, has a special love for traveling people, for minorities. And we choose to be here because the people are outside the reach of church or to be a presence of Jesus here in the midst of them, because they travel every day. They could not be reached in another way than living with them. We receive a lot from people. It's a sharing, I think. Yeah.
They bless us. They let us know by the fact that they're here willing to work for us, being who they are, work with us, that what we do is a good thing and a godly thing and to be done. That's a blessing. The overall effect is that there's a softening effect that they bring to a very hard-nosed, rough and tumble business. And it has to be rough and tumble if it's going to move every day and be this big. I really think that they are a tender spot. Everyone senses it. Everyone that comes in any contact with it all senses that.
Your vocation is to be as leaven in the dough, plunged into the midst of the world. So do not let yourself be cut off from it. Do not think that living among people will hinder your life of union with God. Do not set up barriers between the world and yourself.
One community of Little Sisters has lived on Chicago's West Side since the late 1950s. In 1969, Little Sister Dorothea was killed by a stray bullet as she slept. Two gangs were facing off in the alley, and the sister's friend, Eddie, fired in the air to scare off the rival gang. With this accidental shooting, the Little Sisters entered another level of sharing the life of their friends and neighbors.
The people of our neighborhood were very upset because as they are upset when it is one of their own who is hit like that, an innocent victim, you know. But the next morning, their main question was, are you going to stay with us, or are you scared, and are you going to run away from this neighborhood, you know? But this was really a testimony, because we had shared their life in that way, that they were very close to us, and there was a lot of compassion in a way on both sides, and they were very touched, you know, when we said that we intended to stay.
I always thought that you could offer your life to God, do ordinary work, and still live right among people. There's a kind of friendship that has grown up between many of us, and it's hard to explain, but I think it has bonded us in a way that we would never have become close if we were, say, social workers and then went away in the evening. I think it's made a big difference that we stay here day and night. Also that I have to stand in the sun, take the same bus, stand in the cold. So I do think it makes a big difference. Little gestures of friendship, of kindness, and of not being fearful of one another, just like people become in big cities.
What does it mean for God to come and give himself into human hands, you know, at the mercy of and dependent on the care of other human beings, that meeting other people is somehow also in the image of God? And it's true. I mean, she said, you look at the hardest person in the presence of a baby, that it disarms the hardest heart, you know, that it's a way of reaching other people. And she wanted us to learn from that a way of being that can set other people at ease and make relationship possible, because the defenses can come down so that then what is beautiful inside them can come out, you know, and you can touch it, and it can give itself to the world.
I've been knowing them for 20 years, and they're just like family to me. They go out their way to me. It's just nice people to know, to communicate, to get along. They'll pick you up when you're down and visit you. Just like one big happy family.
Our life must be because of Jesus and the gospel. Otherwise it has no sense. And in order for it to be because of Jesus and the gospel, we have to be prepared to spend hours in prayer, to spend hours in meditation. But a contemplative life is not only the prayer life, you know? It's also the way we look at life, the way we look at things, the way we look at the people.
When we love, we want to speak endlessly with the one we love. Prayer is nothing else. A familiar conversation with the beloved, to gaze on him, to tell him that we love him, to rejoice to be at his feet.
In the image of Jesus in the Eucharist, Charles de Foucauld wanted to be all things to all people, to be as bread broken and shared for all. Many lay people and diocesan priests have been nourished by his words and the example of his life. The Jesus Caritas Priests Fraternities have members worldwide who meet regularly for prayer and sharing.
What attracted me initially to the fraternity was to find some other priests who took their priesthood both seriously and their prayer life seriously. The fraternity provided me with this kind of a framework, a desire to be one with others who were struggling to be faithful, a desire to pray and to have time of quiet, and also to be able to be filled with a sense of joy for and with whom I work. It provides just a minimal amount of support to do that. It doesn't create an overburdening structure.
To know the gospel is to be able to live it. It's not necessarily easy all the time, but this fraternity helped me to sort that out with my brother priests. You know, like, hey, I'm struggling home. Things were difficult this week. Where do I go from there, you know?
3 years after I was ordained, when I discovered Brother Charles and his spirituality, it's like a bell rang. I said, this is it. This is my calling. There's no question about it. Because it incorporated both things, a contemplative life of being present to God, and then this immersion among the poorest and becoming one and with them and present to them in the same way. And it has never ceased to turn me on.
For us who follow the spirituality of Brother Charles, it's necessary for us to meet God both day and night in the emptiness of our own hearts. If our hearts are filled with all kinds of things and all kinds of obsessions and all kinds of possessions and all kinds of needs, we seem somehow to push God out. Each month we have a desert day, and it's a significant amount of time, 6 to 8 hours of clearing out all of the things that I do. It's not a time to prepare sermons, it's not a time to prepare a class, it's a time to simply be still before God, to take time to be still in the presence of the mystery.
Brother Charles was ahead of his time in recognizing the role and mission of the laity as witnesses to the gospel, according to this spirituality of Nazareth.
I'm part of a precious group of people. We support one another, love each other like a family. We meet on Fridays in someone's house. We pray together, have gospel sharing, and at the end, we have something to eat together. Our Jesus Caritas community has been a tremendous support in the work that we are doing here. As we feel the love and care of one another, we feel sent to reach out and to love others.
The spirituality of Charles de Foucauld consists of being present to God and present to those around us. We need to live this presence in a balanced way.
We have to love everyone that comes our way, and I try to think of, well, how did Charles love them? How can I love my children each day the way he loved them? Maybe the way he loved the children that came to him. How can I serve God's people in the midst of the city? How can I be what they call a little beacon light? And as I begin to think more about that, I remember the prayer, his wonderful prayer of abandonment, and I begin to say to myself, when I can't do it, maybe Charles can show me through this prayer how he did it. And that's basically how I live today. I think about Charles and the impact he's made in my life is, how can I bring myself to prayer every day? How can I bring the children that I work with, the people in this community, how can I become, through this fraternity that we are, a more loving presence of Christ in the world? And this is how I live it day by day.
Father, I abandon myself into your hands. Do with me what you will. Whatever you may do, I thank you. I'm ready for all. I accept all. Let only your will be done in me and in all your creatures. I wish no more than this, O Lord. Into your hands I command my soul. I offer it to you with all the love of my heart, for I love you, Lord, and so need to give myself, to surrender myself into your hands, without reserve and with boundless confidence, for you are my Father. Amen.